Dear brothers and sisters, we have gathered here to witness Shanice and Eric pledge their hearts and lives to one another in holy matrimony. May we experience God's presence, love, and guidance as they take their first step forward as husband and wife. Through our prayers, let us assure Shanice and Eric that we are with them as they begin their journey together. We pray that the Lord may help them to abide in love and to be with them as they begin their new life in the sacrament of marriage. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
As we prepare to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us acknowledge that we are sinners and ask God for forgiveness and strength. You were sent to heal the contrite. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You pledge for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
The Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
For Shanice and Eric, with faith in you and in you. Father, they pledge their love today. May their lives always bear witness to the reality of that love. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
My soul, I'm here.
12 years. And though she had spent all her living on physicians, she could not be healed by anyone. She came up behind him and touched the fringe of his garment. And immediately her discharge of bleeding ceased. Jesus said, "Who was it that touched me?" When all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the crowds are surrounding you and are pressing in on you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me, for I perceive that power has gone out of me." When the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him, declared in the presence of all the people why she had touched him and how she had been immediately healed. Jesus said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
You know, some months ago when I suggested this reading, everybody looked at me and said, "It's too embarrassing a reading for today." I agree. Now that the woman has been healed of her problem, let's give her a sign. And let's get to what we just heard of the readings of today. I prepared my homily, but then the readings made me change my mind. I'll get back to it. The first reading talks about love, 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 love. What is love? Now don't turn around and tell me the basis of marriage is love, is it? Mother say yes. I don't know. Is the basis of marriage love? You know, I became a priest and didn't get married because I saw the movie Fiddler on the Roof. And when Topo asks his wife, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" Before St. Peter, Peter answered immediately, "Yes, Lord, I love you." You know, Peter was in the habit of answering things without thinking, putting both his feet into his own mouth. Topol's wife did not reply. It's only at the third time that he asked, she said yes. "For 25 years I've done this, I've done that, I've done this, I've done everything. And me in my life, I said, I am fed up of doing things. I need to be able to sit back and realize a little more. Not keep on doing. Marriage is not working. It's not like you've been put together to pull apart or something. No. We are not partners. We are not joined to work. Then what is love? All things are a very beautiful explanation of love. But in the original things, it's called charity, not love. Now to me, love is more of an infatuation. It's a beautiful word. Nobody really knows the meaning of it. And nobody knows how to put it into practice. Like all of us pray all the time for peace. Don't we? At the moment we are praying for peace and persecution. But we are not saying who's the cause of it, am I? Let's not get into politics. But we are praying for peace. So what is peace? Peace is absence of war. Isn't it? No, people say I was a very bad teacher. I ask questions and you always say, "Peter, that's not good teaching." Peace is not absence of war. Peace is something positive. But Jesus sometimes says, "My peace I give unto you." So there is my peace and your peace?
Yeah.
And there it is. So peace is not just absence of war. Peace is something like what love is. Something that we don't understand. Peace says that I go out of my way, sacrificing myself in order to do something very special. I see I'm watching you, I'm very glad for that. And we're singing the responsorial song. Did you pay attention to the words? He sang, it's a beautiful, beautiful hymn, beautiful hymn, beautiful music. Shepherd of my soul, I give you full control. This is not the original version. That's what put me off. What made me change my homily on the spot? Two of you are going to get married in a few minutes. So you're giving yourself, you full control to him, and he gives full control to you. Yes? No, thank you. The first time somebody has said no. That's not marriage. Marriage is not surrendering my control to my partner. No. Though St. Paul a number of times said, husbands or wives should be subject to their husband. No. The father doesn't like that. All right? But that's not the truth. We need to learn to live together. And I'm against love. I am for something more deeper and more meaningful than just love. And what is that? That is called intimacy. Again, the smiles are because we think of only one in your intimacy. Because we are a little narrow in our thinking. I'm not talking about sexual intimacy. The number of intimacies that are possible. Physical intimacy, psychological intimacy, emotional intimacy, and intellectual intimacy. That's where a couple needs to be able to share. We share all these forms of intimacy. And why do we share them? In order to build up or achieve. Now in today's world we see there are a lot of people who are living together as a couple, but unfortunately as strangers. We are not at an intimate relationship. We live together, yes. Unfortunately, once again, the best invention of modern times has made inroads into the life of others. I hope you haven't brought your mobile phones along. No, thank you. All right? The mobile phone has taken precedence over every relationship. So I need to be able to say, no, we require physical intimacy. Not over the mobile phone. We are losing something very important in our human culture. So we need to go back to that. Now, how do we create this intimacy of relationship? The first thing is, in a relationship, the other does not complete you, but we share interdependence. I need the other person to make me complete. No. But we are interdependent. Not dependent. Psychology tells us we should not be dependent on anybody. But there is interdependence, which means that enough of give and take in our relationship. That is relationship. Again, the person you love is a person, not an ideal. So your love has to be like Romeo and Juliet. Isn't it? We say no now, even the bit. All right. Romeo and Juliet, they never persons. They were ideals. Because they were ideals, their love was such an ideal that they both had to commit suicide. That is God's intimacy. It's good for us to realize it. So, we have to love each other as persons, not as ideals. And don't look for the ideal husband. I attended a birthday party of a nice beautiful girl in Mexico, and someone else who got just got married, and I was present at that wedding, he was driving me back home. And I said, okay, your marriage has been fixed for January, fine, good. What about the other three girls? He said, Father, they are stupid. So I said, what? He says, they are stupid. I said, why? Because they're looking out for the ideal man. I was shocked. And today I'm using that. Yeah. The ideal person does not exist, and thank God. Because if any of us was perfect, then there can be no relationship. Because I know everything. So there's no relationship. Right? Learn from each other and heal yourself. And better part, don't accuse the other. Heal yourself. Start with yourself. Look at the shortcomings within. Once you start healing that, the other living relationship heals itself. I don't have to criticize. I don't have to find fault. It gets healed by itself. Now, get comfortable being alone. In marriage, yes, yes, don't admit it. Be comfortable being alone. Even in marriage, I have to respect the other's space. Very, 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 very important. If you learn to do that, to find comfort in being yourself, then you will be safe and you will be whole. You become a wholesome person. I am not dependent constantly on the other. Makes a lot of sense. And something which I keep telling a lot of people who come to me is to learn to have self-acceptance. Self-acceptance is very important. Try and get yourself and see, are you comparing yourself at any time, in any respect, to somebody else? Don't say no. Sometimes I saw it, I hope I was a little taller. I hope I was a little slimmer. I hope I was a little better. Makes no difference. I need to learn to be happy with who I am. I need to be satisfied with who I am. That is maturity. That is self-acceptance. If I can do that, yes, then relationship, intimacy starts developing. Let go of expectations. No expectations from whom? From the other, right? No. No expectations even from myself. Don't have any expectations. If I need to do something, I will do it. Without any expectation for myself or from another, or for another. These, I think, are important things that we need to keep in mind. That we cannot forget that woman wears this job. We'll get back to her. That was the reading of the Gospel of today. It's rather rude of the part of Jesus to bring out something so personal out in public, isn't it? No one likes to disclose these things in public. And yet Jesus makes us say it in public. Why? He won't even insult her, he won't insult her. Why does he do that? Because in marriage, there's nothing now that remains right. Everything that happens between us needs to be shared. And the longer you delay in sharing something, the worse for you. The more difficult it becomes to mention, to say. The moment you say, then we understand each other and we accept one another and we say, yes, he is telling the truth, I know, or she is telling the truth, I know. It's very important. So Jesus was not trying to shame her. No, he was trying to make it very clear to you and you that today you have touched my garment and you are here. Yes. Shepherd my soul, he has brought you here. It's not an accident. So he is there with you and he wants you to build that bond. Unfortunately, I'm a Jesuit, and St. Ignatius of Loyola has one of the rules which he calls secret love. If you're spending a lot of your energy, a lot of it, trying to hide something from your partner, then you know there is a problem and issue. So secrets, not only among you, among every one of us, if you have got too many secrets and you're guarding them, then there is something which is not healthy. The lesser secrets you have, the better and the freer person you are. Ignatius was not stupid. He understood human nature very well. So, learn to be free. Learn to be able to share. Learn to say, yes, I was mistaken. Yes, I fell. Yes, I committed a fault. And if somebody shouts back at you for being truthful, then there is a problem with the other person, not with you. So you see, it's very simple. Ignatius gave us something which was beautiful. Let's keep that in mind and start moving, as we said right from the introduction. We have come here, all of us. Can you tell me why? Why have you come here this evening? Anyone? I'm deaf, so we have to speak loud. To witness, one witness, sorry, because one witness is there, and the other one is the other witness. Why have we come here? Because we love them. I don't love them, and yet I'm here.
You require at least two witnesses.
We make it a little more jazzy. Good? All right. Can we have the two witnesses please coming forward? Shanice and Eric, you are here today so that the Lord may seal your love in the presence of the church's minister and this community. Christ abundantly blesses this love. He has already consecrated you in baptism, and now he enriches you and strengthens you by a special sacrament, so that you may assume the duties of marriage in mutual and lasting fidelity. And so, in the presence of the church, I ask you to state your intentions. Shanice and Eric, have you come here freely, without reservation, to give yourselves to each other? Do you love and honor and take each other as husband and wife for the rest of your life?
Yes, I do.
Yes, I do.
Will you accept children lovingly from God and bring them up according to the law of Christ?
Yes, I will.
Yes, I will.
Shanice and Eric, since it's your intention to enter into the sacrament of marriage, join your right hands and express your intention before God. Lord, bless these rains. In your holy name, may these rains be a symbol of Shanice and Eric's faith in you and in each other. May these rains always remind them of the deep love they pledge today. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Wear this ring as a sign of my unconditional love, respect, and fidelity to you, as your husband and friend.
Shanice and Eric, you expressed before God and this congregation your consent to be one in life to come. May you always keep your vows close to your hearts. I, together with your families and friends, pray that the Lord may, in his goodness, strengthen your consent and enrich you with his blessings. What God has joined, no one must separate. As a representative of the church and in God's name, I now proclaim you husband and wife, and bless your union in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Congratulations.
Shanice married very well. My love, my home, my mother, my children, my children, my children, my I can go. And yet there are no words to describe what you are to me. Only my idea. It's always a boy. As a 14-year-old boy trying to get your attention, or as I stand here today, 15 years later, still trying to get your attention. Shanice, I like you. I like you as a person so very much. I like your heart when you see someone wrong. I like your mind when curious questions lead to late night conversations. I like your dance moves when you plan just enough to dream. I like your passion for life and love for any creature that you want, even the ones that scare you. I like how incredibly talented yet humble you are, though I know you don't fully realize the amazing things you can do. I like how fiercely independent you are and always how up those you love without a second thought. I like how the simplest of things make you the happiest. That makes me the happiest. I like your persistence in trying to make me happy and get you. I like how well I know you, yet how often you surprise me. I like your belief that this world should be fair, and I like the person you have become. We've learned to love, we've learned to fight, we've learned that it isn't always going to go our way. But I know there's nothing we've not faced yet. I promise to listen, to confide in you, to talk softer, to wait my turn and not interrupt you, and to let nothing be left unsaid. I promise to give you my shoulder to sleep on and that you walk on. Feed you fried chicken burgers on an annual Tuesday just us. Solve all of your math problems because you've already told someone that I will. And protect you from all the dangers when you enter the room. I promise to always be in your corner and support your dreams. A marriage of equals, sharing the load, standing side by side for our adventures. I promise to build a family with you, a home and a safe haven, to be the husband that you deserve and not all the kids of the world. I promise to join you in your spontaneous shenanigans and not let life get too serious, even when we're 82. I can't wait to grow old with you. More than anything, I promise to love you with all of my heart as my best friend and life partner, and to show you that love always and I love you. This is my vow to you for all my life.
this time, Lord, for all creation, for your goodness, we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. But you know, I'm never satisfied as a teacher. If any of my students here will tell you, I never said very good. I said good when you can do better. It's true what you said. So that water, drop of water, represents you and me. Make sense? And the wine represents Jesus. Correct? So we with Jesus. Agreed? Sure? What happens after I say the words of consecration? Yes. Save my soul. Alright? Never mind, God will have consideration. Now, what happens? Before that, the priest offers the host and the wine. You're offering that host to God, right? Whom does that host belong to?
The Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Father,
All powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him, you enter into a new covenant with your people. You restored man to grace in the saving mystery of redemption. You gave him a share in the divine life through his union with Christ. You made him an heir of Christ's eternal glory. This outpouring of love in the new covenant of grace is symbolized in the marriage covenant that reflects your divine plan of love. And so, with the angels and all the saints in heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in the unending hymn of praise, saying,
Joseph, the spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints
who have pleased you through all the ages, we may merit to be called heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus the Christ. Don't forget to say the Amen with gusto. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At our Savior's command and call by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who
trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Communion, right? What do you receive?
The body and blood of Christ.
Body and blood of Christ, not the flesh of Christ. Flesh is meat. Flesh is dead, meat. You come to receive the body and blood of Christ. Come to the altar to receive the living Jesus Christ. It's not dead meat, it's the living Christ. So when you put the body and blood together, the person is alive. If they're separated, that's death. What is Samuel Cox? Behold the Lamb of God, Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say to me,
and my soul shall be healed. In the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep us safe for eternal life.
Thank you.
Lord, in your love, you have given us this Eucharist to unite us with one another and with you. As you have made Eric and Shanice one in the sacrament of marriage and in the sharing of the one bread and the one cup, so now make them one in love for each other. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May Almighty God, with his word of blessing, unite your hearts in the never-ending bond of pure love, so that the peace of Christ may always be with you and in your home.
Amen.
Amen. May you always bear witness to the love of God in this world, so that the afflicted and the needy will find in you generous friends and welcome you into the joys of heaven.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go forth. Thanks be to God.
Thank you all.